Great. This is going to be a good one. Everybody, welcome to Digital Asset News. Top stories in crypto, break it down in bite-sized pieces. So today, just the thumbnail and the title suggest, we're going to take a look at just why this particular April has been so harsh and where we could potentially go in the future. So we'll take a quick look back about what is going on as far as like the months and also the days leading up to May 1st as we move forward. Also, there's a new story, North Korea potentially responsible for the Axie hack of $625 million. Now it all makes sense as far as what President Joe Biden here in the United States put forth as far as national security, because this, I think, is a pretty big deal. Also, we'll take a look at crypto fit or crypto fitness, I don't want to call it, as a battle rages on with near protocol. Then lastly, we'll take it semi-clown news, Wolf of Wall Street, crypto hater to crypto player. And this guy's making a good lot of money just talking about crypto. And then lastly, we'll do five questions in 5 minutes. So hold all your questions till the very end, and we'll do all this great stuff. So first of all, if you're here for the live stream, thanks. You know that if you're here for the recording, just know there's going to be timestamps below, so you can skip around whatever you want to do. First thing we're going to do, news, takes about 15 minutes. Then next, we'll do the questions. So let's jump into it, huh? We got time is precious. So this is what's going on. Taking a look at the market itself. Not a great day. And it's, is it the 18th? Yes, perfect. So this, of course, you're going to hear a lot about taxes, people paying taxes. And this is the last day in the United States where we can pay taxes. And you can file an extension, but you still got to pay. And that's just how it works. You know, government's going to get their money. They may be late in other things, but darn it, you're going to have their money when they want it. That's just how it is. So we take a look at what's going on, and potentially that could be it. There's other factors. No one really knows all the stories or everything that's going on, but could be a potential. And we're at 1.9 trillion, and we've lost roughly almost 100 billion in like 3 or 4 days. Right? It's amazing to me. Like we drop a little bit. It's like putting a frog in water. You know, you just slowly turn up the heat and they won't jump out. And that's how I feel like this market is going. It's like it slowly degrades and degrades. And we're like, oh, this is fine. Everything's on fire. But it's not fine. And we see like over 7 days. I mean, look at that. Bitcoin down 7%. Ethereum 9%. BNB negative 3%. Every 24 hour, you know, it is what it is. Except for Terra. That's what's holding up most of my portfolio these days. So Terra holders, congratulations. Hey, look at that. Even their stable coins in the top 13 there. It's pretty interesting. Now, let's see. Any big gainers? No, just a bunch of temporary losers, except for Chain, 6.1%. Congratulations. Frackshare, sure, 10% almost. StepN, we're going to talk about that in a second, 9.4% and 20% in 7 days. That is crypto fitness. So let's just move into the story, which is this. Why is this April so harsh? What the heck is going on? And where is it all leading us to? So what I like to do, let's take a look at quick data, which this is Ben's website. I talk about all the time. This guy should start paying me. I'm just kidding, Ben. But it is a great website. And I like how he puts everything together. And then, of course, he's always got a nice little video underneath that explains what he's talking about, because so he can break it down for simpletons like myself. Anyhow, so if we take a look at this one, and I've showed this before, I always thought that April was a crappy month because people are selling for, you know, crypto. And no, the United States isn't the entire world. It's just the entire world to me, because I live in the United States. Sorry, we're all a bunch of homers. And when I take a look at this, I'm like, you know, if you just take a look at April, in all honesty, let's just take out 2022. Because right now, we're down 14%, roughly 15% for the monthly returns. Okay, month over month. 2021 is down a little bit, but bearable. Okay, 2020, 19, it was pretty good months. I mean, if you take a look at the whole spectrum, the better months would probably be around October. November is a great month, so just remember that. And then December, also October is a good one. That's what kind of is spurring my thesis of sell in May and go away, because June, July, August, September aren't the greatest months, and then October, November, December kind of picks up. But again, past performance does not equal future results. I said it right finally. So if we take a look at this, you know, it's should be a pretty good month, but what's going on? Because right now we're in the middle of it. And when I thought to myself, I'm like, is this just an outlier? Is this just how it is? Now we got to look back in the actual charts. So let's look back. Let's start with 2020. And again, this is from March 20th to May 4th. Let's just take a little wider spectrum. Now, when in doubt, zoom out, but sometimes you got to zoom in to get the big picture. So if we take a look at this right here, so let's see. So we're around 3rd of April, right? And of course, tax season is always the same time for us, you know. And April's kind of choppy for most of the month, up and down, up and down. And then we get to around when everybody's got to start paying and, you know, US is cracking down. Pay me my money. And you see little dips here. And then it's like, okay, 15, 16, 18. Goes up a little bit, little dip. Maybe people paid late or whatever else. And it kind of just takes off. I'll take that. 30th of April, off we go. Same thing over here. So again, we're in March. Let's go to April. April 1st, things kind of do pretty well. But there's little dips and it goes sideways. And then again, as people start getting paid off on their tax obligations, because there's some degenerates out there. Hey, I used to be one of those. I mean, I'll be honest with you. I'd pay late. I'm like, sorry, but they just penalize me and then I pay more, which always sucks. And then it just takes off. And that is in 2019. And then same thing here. I went to 31st of March. Again, a little choppy. Down here, look at this. 15 people paying off. And it starts to take off. And then there's little, you know, fluctuations that come back. So what I'm trying to get to the point of, as we take a look at all these things, this is a weird one. This is 2017. That was that parabolic bull run. I can't really, there's always little outliers. Same thing here, 8th of April, you know, people pay off and then bam, goes up and there's a little bit of pullback, so on and so forth. But what I'm trying to say is that this, even though April right now so far, let's just be honest, it's kind of sucking. Hopefully, as things move forward, taxes aren't such much a big thing and people kind of already paid off. I know people's like James is always like, well, if you're really on top of it, then you should have everything ready and in place and you'll have all the payments that you need for taxes. Maybe for James is a pretty responsible guy, but not everybody is super responsible. Some people pay late, some people get lazy, and that's just what it is. So I'm hoping that's where we're at moving forward. So that's what I kind of think of what's going on. Let me know what you think in the comments section. Hopefully we'll see a better April and hopefully a better May and we'll go from there. So that leads me to my next story. And I haven't heard too many people talk about it. I don't know if you've heard about this, but this is an older story. It's April 16th. What's the day? So this is set. So it's over the weekend. So maybe, I'm not for sure, but I found it fascinating and it kind of makes sense as to why the president and his administration put out a call for a deep dive into crypto and digital assets. And he talks about financial stability, national security, and climate risks, but I'll get to that in a second. So this was a couple of days ago. Blockchain expert explains how North Korea's $625 million crypto hack presents a new national security threat. I never thought of it this way, but it does make sense. So here's what we got. U.S. authorities this week tied North Korean hackers to the historic $625 million Axie Infinity crypto swindle. And on Thursday, U.S. Treasury Department added an Ethereum wallet address to its sanction list after the wallet facilitated transfers for more than $86 million of stolen funds. Also, there's another story that I didn't cover where Tornado for that mixing solution for crypto transactions, where you can kind of hide a little bit of transactions. Correct me in the comment section, but they are working with certain organizations to eliminate some of these sanctioned countries. So now this kind of makes sense, even more so. Anyhow, more than 86 million hacking outfits, Lazarus and APT38, both linked to North Korea, were behind the theft. The FBI said in a statement, funds are generating revenue from Kim Jong-un's regime. Look, it's not a political channel, but I thought it was interesting how things are going. And then to refresh your memory about what happened here, how this happened, this is how it happened. Hackers stole over $600 million. This is how they did it. Through Ronin. Ronin is a blockchain protocol linked to Axie. Ronin said on Tuesday blog that they stole $625 million, which was 173,000 Ether and 25 million USDC. The heist, which wasn't detected until almost a week after, which is kind of weird. It wasn't detected until a week after it occurred. Believed to be one of the biggest in the history. I think it was the biggest. A hack used to mean loss of passwords and usernames, but in the age of crypto, it means the loss of life savings, which is a great point. I'm going to say this again because it's a great point. A hack used to mean loss of passwords and usernames, But in the age of crypto, it means the loss of life savings. And it's the same thing that's going on right now with the scams. And you see them all the time on YouTube. YouTube, I'm watching you. You're doing a horrible job at getting rid of all these scams. It's constant. So I'm just going to tell you like this, everybody. Treat everything as a scam. Everything. Even if you think that I'm contacting you, hint, I'm not contacting you. Treat everything as a scam until proven otherwise. Your bank account will thank you later. So anyhow, back to the story. So this one here, crypto heist exploited the key oversight. It wasn't a key oversight. It was a mistake. That's what it was. Sky Mavis, the developer behind Axie, built a sidechain, a secondary blockchain for faster, cheaper transactions, since transactions on the Ethereum blockchain are expensive. I think we all know that. Sidechains had 9 validator nodes. 9. That's it. And it was really centralized. Sky Mavis oversaw 5. And the DAO for Axie controlled 4. Sky Mavis said it discontinued its agreement with the DAO in December, but never revoked the permissions it allowed. So when I was reading this, I'm like, oh, well, that's how they did it. They just went into the DAO, they hacked the DAO, and they went through because the permissions weren't taken away. But that's not what the hackers did. The hackers actually took over Sky Mavis's validator nodes, the ones that they were in charge of. So how good were these hackers? Sky Mavis, the ones who created Axie, their validator nodes got hacked, and only one from Axie DAO is the one that got hacked. And the problem was is that they never revoked the permission. So if you have 9, now you got 5 that are in control of supposedly North Korea. That means you can do what you want. They never remove what was meant to be a temporary measure. It was an outright error. And that is the story for how that happened. Now we go back to this one about what does this all mean? So over the last few years, hold on, that's that. Ah, yeah. Ari Redboard, head of legal and government affairs at Blockchain, said this. Over the last few years, many hacks have been perpetrated by North Korea. But the magnitude of this one, I mean, 625 million is pretty good, shows things that moved from small exploits to true national security concerns, which, of course, what we're talking about, this makes a lot of sense. This is right from the President of the United States and his counsel. There's going to be an outline, a strategy to protect consumers, financial stability, national security, and address climate risks. Because gone are the days for massive military use only. Now anybody can be an economic hitman. And if you don't know what that term is, just Google it. Watch some pretty good videos on economic hitmen, mostly the US, unfortunately. And you will see exactly what's going on here. So if these countries are allowed to do this, hey, I think you can do a lot more damage fiscally sometimes than what you can do militarily. Although we see what's going on in the Ukraine. Anyhow, to finish this up, for years, North Korea's actors have been responsible for cyber attacks. I had no idea. Including a high profile hit against Sony. In 2014, North Korea realized a hack against an online retailer was one thing, but going after crypto exchange is a more effective way to fund destabilizing activity at a very low cost to them. So again, economic hitmen. That's interesting. And now it all makes sense. So let me know what you think about that in the comments section. Let's move on to second to last piece. And this is interesting. Crypto fit or crypto fitness with Near Protocol. Now it's starting to make sense also as I'm putting these pieces together. So yesterday we were talking about the Dan DeGen channel, where I start to talk about up and coming projects that are like super early, like either have not a private sale, but are in pre-sale and aren't even out yet. And it's very hard to figure out which ones are good, which ones are trash. But I've got a pretty good group of people that are crypto OGs that I've met in Puerto Rico and around, and they send me some pretty good projects. Anyhow, one of those, which they sent me late, I might add, but this is from another group, actually. It was StepN. And I talked about this briefly after I talked about my degenerate plays that I've done reviews on over at Digital Asset News DGen. We talked about Genzakishi, Everdome, Fame MMA, and there's a new one. And I'm just talking about what I've done so far and how I've gotten into it. So real quick, these places don't pay me a dime, but I do get to actually invest into them And I have skin in the game. So just so everybody is clear on where we're at. And there's a, and we go into lockup periods and tokenomics and all that good stuff. So with this, I was like, I want to do a deep dive into StepN. And when I said that, I got a bunch, I got people like, no, Rob, don't, we don't want to hear, we don't want you to talk about StepN. You're going to drive the price of the shoes up. And I only have three pairs. And I was like, okay, I'll wait. And then someone said, you know, half the support on Discord is people asking for activation codes because you can't actually get into this until you get an activation codes for these NFTs. It's a thing. And the people that I talked to were like, hey, I'm making like $500 a day just walking around. And I'm like, this is utility. I don't know why this isn't working. It usually does. But I also heard that they updated the app and there was some problems there. But anyhow, if we're talking about real world utility, I mean, this makes a lot of sense, right? For activity, moving around, getting NFTs, getting things into there. And I'm like, that's interesting. So when I was going to start to do the deep dive, I used Brave browser and I clicked on Brave to start doing my stuff yesterday. And this thing came up and I was like, oh, look at that, sweat and near. And I was like, okay. And I started doing some things. And then I came back and then I saw this ad. Ah, sweat and near. That's interesting. And actually, I'm just going to try this and see if this works. This worked when I was messing around. But like every time I refresh, like in three or four chances, let's see. One, two, three. Yeah, there it is. Let's do this again. One, two, three, four. There he is. One, two, three, four. So this is ad placement on Brave browser. And just so you know, it's expensive. I know the guys that do this stuff, and it's like six-figure type of ads. And I'm like, that's interesting. Sweat and near. So I took a look real quick at sweat. And this thing came up, sweat coin. I'm like, okay. So I looked at sweat coin. And I was like, ah, preview only. But it did give me the website, which I do like that by CoinGecko. So I took a look at the website. And I was like, introducing sweat the token. 64 million registered users. I don't know how that's possible. 100 million predicted new users. Number one in 20 countries. This hasn't even gone forth. And I'm like, piqued my interest. And then I started to just do a quick thing. Sweat coin to reward physical movement with crypto. And let's see. The co-founder said, we're going to make this thing great. Sure, whatever. But this was the interesting part. I mean, every founder says they're going to make it great, right? Sweatcoin has selected eco-friendly NEAR as the blockchain for its token. Okay. And additionally, the NEAR Foundation is investing in the project. Well, that's good. This was interesting, though. This really piqued my interest. Project leaders like Terra founder Do Kwon, Sandeep Nalwal, nailed it, founder of Polygon, and Bjorn Wagner, co-founder of Parity or Polkadot. They're all going to be, as far as institutional backers. And then this is from the founder. One of NEAR's core missions is to help onboard the world of Web3. Collaborating with the Sweat Foundation allows us to take a step closer to mission. Company aligns with our core values of sustainability. NEAR's carbon neutral blockchain empowers more people to work towards a more sustainable future. So like when I saw this and I was looking at this, I'm like, you know, what I'm always talking about on this channel, UTT, when I'm getting into new projects, the utility, what does this do? Is it a Me Too project or does it actually do something unique? And there's actually room for it. And it actually has a function. Okay, check. The team, who's behind it, who's investing into it? That looks pretty good. Tokenomics, I have no idea. I have to really do my due diligence, so I have no idea. But I want to add a fourth component to that UTT. And it's going to be called UTTC, which I should have always added this in, which is, stands for community. The thing that I like about these projects that I've gotten into so far, Genso Kishi, it was called Elemental Knights. And it was already on the Nintendo Switch, is already on the PlayStation. It already had, it was on Android and iOS. So it had a built-in player base, a lot of people. So I'm like, well, that makes sense. Now they're going to move over to the metaverse and for play to earn. So it's seamless, right? Everdome, they had already teamed up with MetaHero and they already had this like, and Tencent, and they already had these built-in mass amount of people. Check. Fame MMA is already, it's been going on since 2018 and it's been expanding rapidly. And for over the last three pay-per-view for their mixed martial arts thing, they've averaged over 500,000 buys. And they've got, the fighters are like influencers, which is crazy. It's like YouTubers and TikTokers and ex-UFC fighters and things like that. So I'm like, they already have a built-in base. And now with this one, this sweat coin, I'm like, could be the next thing. But again, I just found it was interesting and I can't tell you anything. Can't tell you anything else. I can tell you it's not even out for sale, but it'll probably be something I'll take a look at. And I just found it interesting. So that's what's going on for that piece. Let me know what you think about that. And then let me know something, because I want to coin a term. It's either crypto fit or crypto fitness. And I can tell you that if StepN's here and now we've got something like that, it's, to me, it's just makes sense that the natural evolution of getting people into crypto would be that. All you got to do is download on your phone, even if you got an Apple Watch, and just start walking and get tokens. Makes sense to me. Anyhow, I think it's crypto fit. Let me just think about that in the comment section, and then we'll finish up with a funny story. Oh, sorry, excuse me. I did forget about this. This was interesting. Near Protocol, I had to get it on, I think it was a DEX. No, it wasn't a DEX. Some wacky exchange that I use for all my degenerate plays. But just so you know, FTX is going to be listed on, or FTX, Near Protocol is going to be listed on FTX, upcoming listing. So if you're looking for Near, which is the ones that are hooking up with this guy's, might be something to look at. I actually own it already. And if you're looking for a place to, for wallets and exchanges, I've even got FTX right here. There's an affiliate link. If you don't, if you can't stand using affiliate links, don't use it. Go right to FTX. But it's the official link, and you get a certain amount of Bitcoin or something if you sign up. It fluctuates between Voyager and Celsius and KuCoin and Kraken and all these places. So just so you know. And then I also tell you the things that I don't like on this. And there's a link in the description for that. Anyhow, on to Wolf of Wall Street. Finally. Okay. This one was funny. And before I get into this, I just want to show you this. This was a great one. Let me stop this screen. Let me share my screen. Go into the tab. Because I want you to actually hear it. I don't want you to hear me. So let me mute myself.
Hey guys, Jordan Belfort here. Listen, I hate to say I told you so, so I won't say it more than once. But guys, I've told you that Bitcoin was going to get destroyed when it was 18, 19,000, right? And my all I'm saying here is I, you know, I got all this hate mail after that, and I've been silent because I said, let me just allow it to speak for itself what happens, right? But here's the deal, guys. This is just the beginning of the end. When it's not, it hasn't even crashed in the way that this thing will crash when it really takes its move. All right, it has the ability to go to zero, or it can go from to literally 2,000 or 1,000 like that. All right, this is all based on the greater fool theory. I know this better than anyone in the world. I'm not proud of that, but I do. Okay, I lived this. I was the guy on the other side of it. I know what's going on, and this is the beginning of the end. Okay, I'm a believer in blockchain technology. I think there will be great cryptocurrencies out there at some point in time. It's not Bitcoin. All right.
So to be fair, I mean, he did say blockchain is pretty good. He believes in blockchain. Same thing that China, Xi Jinping actually talks about. And same thing that JP Morgan talks about, Jamie Dimon. I believe in blockchain, just don't believe in Bitcoin. Sure. So, and to be honest, I mean, that is a valid point if you're into centralized blockchain technology, which is actually out there. I've done a couple of videos on those things. I just don't really agree with them. So when we take a look at this, that was in 2018. And if you don't know, it's Jordan Belfort. He is the real life example, or the movie that was based off of him, Wolf of Wall Street with Leonardo DiCaprio. Great movies, check it out. So that's him in 2018 saying, you guys are morons. Sure. Which we do hear a lot, let's be honest, either from other billionaires or celebrities or people like this, and just like, you guys are morons. And you know what's funny? The longer that I'm in here, the more I get validated for my thoughts and beliefs in the crypto digital assets. It's amazing to me. All I had to do was just sit here and not really change, just kind of center myself and go, I'm not going to move. And then everybody else kind of comes into that. So I like this part. But so now, 3 years later, 1921, 3.5, Wolf of Wall Street, Jordan Belfort reportedly charged $40,000 for a 2-day crypto workshop at his Miami estate. 3 years after he called Bitcoin a mass delusion. So in a video promoting the event, former stockbroker and convicted, I like how they say this. In a video promoting the event, former stockbroker and convicted felon said he'd been heavily investing in crypto and NFTs, which he called the future of finance. And then here's the picture of the guys that got in there and learned all about crypto. Good for those guys. According to the New York Times report, 9 guests were selected from 600 applicants. 600 people were willing to pay $40,000. I mean, I think that would be kind of cool to actually meet Jordan Belfort. I don't know if it's about the crypto stuff. I think we know more than the average person, but 600 applicants, that's amazing. Despite Belfort's historic distaste for financial regulation, he previously called for massive regulation of digital currency in 2021 with CoinDesk. Now that part, me and him do agree with. He says the sooner that massive regulation comes in the market, better is for Bitcoin, stablecoins, everything else. I think hopefully regulation will come in, but they're going to screw it up because that's what government does. But anyhow, I just found it very interesting that that is what is going on and that people are willing to pay $40,000 just for like a weekend to learn about crypto and digital assets and NFTs and all that stuff. Look, I don't know if you guys know this, but I got a website and it's 100% free. It's danteachescrypto.com. And you can find that. There's a link in the description. And it's all the stuff that I've learned over the last 4 years. So, I mean, maybe those guys would like to not pay for it. But again, you get to meet Jordan Belfort, so I understand. Anyhow, that's what's going on in the news today. I found that that was interesting, all those things that are happening. And that's what we got. So if you got to take off, I'll see you later. I understand. Time is short. But if you want to stick around, let's do 5 questions in 5 minutes, and then we'll get the heck out of here. So let's ask those. Let's get some questions going, huh? And let me stop this banner. All right. Rocky Bobby, Ricky Bobby. It's funny. 40K might actually be a support. Let's hope so. I sure hope so. I do. I don't know. It seems like in the last couple of weeks, you know, everybody's like, well, there's support here. And then we break that support. Oh, there's support here. And it breaks that support. And before you know it, it's like going down. Yeah, smash the likes, people. Thank you to Dez and Beardy for, and I don't know if Mullet's here, but thanks everybody for the to be the administrator. Those are the guys with the wrenches. Kind of keep things holding it down. Oh, that's a great question. Ah, is that a pool or a green screen? I'm not that good at effects, so yeah. Question number 2, Chewy update. That's my dog. He's doing good. We just got to do his last round of chemo for that awful lymphoma, but he's doing great. Running around, everything's good. Good green screen girl. All right. Simple, right? Yeah. Swim while talking about crypto. It's pretty tough to do that with electronics. And let's see. Did you throw your phone in the pool? No, I threw the mosquito repellent. So. This is a great question. What do you think about the next Cardano hard fork? So. As we start moving into, I think these hard forks are going to happen relatively soon. It's going to happen before the merge of Ethereum. I can tell you that. Ah, sorry. I own Ethereum. Don't worry. I feel your pain. But these hard forks, which will be, I think is going to be important for pipelining, which there's a description of that as far as like to increase the throughput or block size. I always forget. That'll help out with moving Cardano forward. And then also, I would like to see some more Hydra action. Hydra, hopefully to sidechain transactions per second, over 1 million. If they can do that, it's a game changer. But the question is if they can do that. So we'll see. But they're pretty good as far as like hitting those milestones. And there's some places that are good and some places that are not. I really don't care. I don't care. Not that I care if they may, I would like them to make it. It'd be great because I own Cardano. I also own Ethereum and Chainlink and and Near and Avalanche and Luna and Solana, all those things, right? And I don't care who wins. I'm not here to be a cheerleader. I'm just here to sit back and go, what's the UTTC? Which one has the greatest utility? Which one has pretty good tokenomics? Which one has a great team? And of course, which one has the best community? And then as far as like what it actually does. So that's why I was so excited about that thing we talked about with crypto fitness or crypto fit. Damn it. Ryan calls me out. How's your Voyager debit card working? I still have it right here. I still have this card. Right. I haven't even activated it yet. I have a Voyager debit card. I transferred a bunch of my money into USDC and Voyager because you get like 9% APY, which I really got to get an anchor protocol. I know people, I say it like every week, but once I use it, I'll let you everybody know. And let's see. Rob, can you talk about setting a stop loss? Well, you can set a stop loss in like, because I only use certain platforms. Mostly it's Voyager to get the different, I mean, they have so many cryptos and it's so easy to use. And then if I can't use that, I use, what is this one? Let me see. I use FTX too and Kraken. I don't use KuCoin anymore because I can't. Is it KuCoin? No, it is KuCoin. KuCoin's the one I use. Yeah. And then Gemini, I don't use Binance because I can't. I can't even use Binance US because I'm in Texas now. And that's about it. So as far as like setting a stop loss, to answer your question, you could do it on Voyager, but you can't really set it at a very maximum away. So let's say you set a stop loss at, I don't know, Bitcoin at 36K. Well, you can't do that. It has to be within a range. And I'm sure there's something that you can read in the FAQ of what the percentages are. But every time I try to set a range for a stop loss, it's like too far away. And so I got to keep tightening and tightening and tightening. That's all I got. And then last question, Rob, does your family get tired of hearing you talk about crypto? No, because I stopped. And we talked about this yesterday about recession and, you know, where people could potentially put their money. I personally don't think that a lot of the people that are really not into crypto right now, I don't think they're really going to try to trust it as things go down. And my prime example is my brother. He's just like, look, you have to understand, when's the last time we had a really bad recession? 2008, 2009 with a housing market crash. After that, it's been bull run city. I mean, peaks and valleys. So we've had like over a decade of some pretty big prosperity. I think people are just going to start keep trusting what they know until they can't. And I think it takes, for people to grow up, it takes a lot of pain. And that's what I see coming forward in the next couple of years. So once they figure that out and they go, wow, they start to understand inflation and quantitative easing. Cause not, I mean, just ask anybody that you walk up to or anybody that in your circle that you don't talk to crypto about, hey, you know what quantitative easing is? And you know how inflation works? And how about fractional reserve lending? They have no idea. So when everything starts to come down, like, oh, well, you know, now the Fed's balance sheet, which is at $9 trillion, they have to offload some of that. It's a pretty good reason why we're starting to see these things in a recession. Just a thought. And then people are like, oh, I get it. But they can't get it until they go through a lot of pain. Long answer for a very short question. Anyhow, thanks so much for watching, guys. I appreciate it. If you like today's video, give it a thumbs up. Also consider subscribing. We talk about these things every single day. Try to give a little insight and we go from there. And also subscribe to the Dan DeGen channel. I just talk about news here. I don't like to talk about the next upcoming projects and the super early ones because they're super risky. And that's like, for me, it's a 5% asset allocation for my portfolio. I don't sell my kidneys and put it all into some crazy wacky project. Just assume you're going to lose everything on those types of things because they're super risky. And that's it. Thanks so much for watching. I do appreciate it. I'll see you on the next one. Adios.